Have you had an encounter with the King of the Forest? If so, drop me a line at contact@buckeyebigfoot.com and tell me all about it. Then I'll share it with everyone. Welcome back to Buckeye Bigfoot, where we take snackage very seriously. And if you don't already have your snackage lined up for tonight, you best get up and go get it all done up, because we're going to go ahead and we're going to jump headfirst right into the encounters tonight, right now. At the time this occurred, I was living in Point Pleasant, West Virginia. Yes, that Point Pleasant of Mothman fame. But the Mothman has nothing to do with what I'm writing you about. At the time, I was recently divorced, and back in 2012, I had this big idea that I was going to be some kind of herbalist, that I'd be able to support myself that way. So I worked extra hard and scraped up the $1,400, and I went online and got the Dominion Herbal College course. Now, it was actually really good stuff, and I learned a lot, but I had a lot more to learn. And one of those things that I needed to learn was how to identify plants out in the wild. A friend of mine lived out off Redmond Ridge. Now, she was interested in a lot of the herbal stuff, too, and I was trying to teach her what I learned. So one Saturday, we went out to Chief Cornstalk. We were going out just to have a look-see to see if there were any plants that we could identify with just our eyes. We weren't there to take any cuttings or to dig anything up, so don't get upset. We just wanted to sharpen our eyes out there, that's all. We were looking down on the ground for plants, and we weren't looking up a great deal. But once I did look up, and I saw something move between two big hickory trees about 50 feet in front of us. I saw something just dark moving between them. I stopped, and I waited, and I watched to see what it was, because it had to come out from behind the second tree, right? But nothing did. I thought, well, that's weird. Was it a person out there watching us? I told my friend about it, and we stood there quiet, just watching and waiting. After about half a minute, I called out hello. I just wanted them to know that I knew they were there. At the time, it seemed weird, but not scary. My ex-husband had given me a 9mm for Christmas one year, and he told me that I should always keep it with me, and I did. I had it with me right then, so I wasn't scared if it was some person out there. I waited another minute after calling out hello, and about the time that we were going to move on down the way and go back to looking for plants, whatever it was suddenly moved and ran. Now, me and my friend were standing there with our mouths open when it did this. It took off down through those old hardwoods so fast I could barely keep my eyes on it. It made a lot of crashing noise as it moved off through the branches and was stepping on stuff. The being that I saw wasn't as tall as most Bigfoots that I hear tale of. This one wasn't no taller than any of my brothers, and they're all 6 feet or under. But the thing was wide. It looked like a football player in a big hairy costume just charging down the field. It was even bent over, heading forward, like it was a football player. Now, I'm not saying that it was somebody in a costume. There's no way anyone could run like that in that area in a costume and not fall over or get caught up on some branch. And when it was running, well, the legs were solid that I saw. They weren't flapping all around like some loose costume you would wear. And I never saw its face. Everything I saw was from the side or the back, and not even clearly from the side, just that point where it walked from tree to tree. I'm pretty sure that as it was running, I saw the defining line where the good Lord split that creature right up the backside. Another thing that I think means it couldn't possibly be a costume. It was a muddy brown color, not at all like the cocoa color of all the hickory bark around me. When it ran, I saw a quick flash of the bare foot when it was lifted up. It was gray-colored and smooth. It moved so fast. It was out of sight in less than 2 seconds. We could hear it crashing off for some ways, but the brush and the low tree limbs made it disappear quickly from our sight. We stood there a long time just watching all the branches and brush settle back into place and finally stop moving. That's when we got out of there. Gun or not, we neither one wanted to run into whatever that was again. Now, me and my friend, we talked about it the rest of the day, and we've talked about it a lot since. We both think it was a Bigfoot. Together, we went through all the other things it could possibly be on this planet. And I tell you, ain't none of them fit. I think we came up on it, and that it was more scared of us. That's my opinion anyway, judging by the way it ran. I never felt scared at any time, though. Glad to share it. Kimberly. Hi, Buckeye Bigfoot. In 2017, me and my dad were in the Flathead National Forest. I was 16 at the time, and this was one of the long weeks that I got to spend with my dad, who lived in northern Idaho. Normally, I had a lot of weekends with him, but I loved having a full week. Now, we'd been into the Nez Perce and the Kootenai a lot over the years, but this was our first time to Flathead. Now, we liked to do a lot of camping and hiking. That's what we did with our long weeks. But the rule was, no cell phones, none of that kind of stuff, just me and him. Dad did have an emergency sat phone on him, but we only almost ever had to use it just one time in all those years, and that was because of some really bad humans one night, not a Sasquatch. That's a whole different story there. This night, we had set camp east of Bear Dance. We had found a spot that seemed unusually clear enough for our tent and flat. It also had a great view of Flathead Lake far below us. It seemed that someone had broken or maybe cut a lot of the limbs away in the area just for the view. It also had no vegetation. So we thought that it was just other people that had been camping there through the years. And we thought, wow, what great luck we had finding it. The ground was flat and, as I mentioned, devoid of vegetation. And the ground looked suspiciously well compacted. You already know from what I just told you, didn't you? You already guessed it. But me and Dad, we didn't catch on right away. First, Dad didn't believe in Sasquatch at that time. Second, we didn't see anything saying any animals were in the area. We walked all around, hundreds of feet in every direction before we made camp. There was no scat. There were no fresh kills. There was nothing. Nothing to tell us that an animal had been using it. In fact, we agreed, it looked way too neat for any animal. I mean, what would you think, right? Camping site? We set up our tent right there. After we got everything set up, we hiked on down to Flathead Lake and decided to get some fishing in. And in one of those, oh, this only happens in the movies kind of moments, Dad ran into someone that he had worked with down on an oil rig in the Gulf of Mexico all the way back in the 1980s. It was freaky. They hadn't seen or talked to each other in decades. And we almost ran literally right smack into him for real. After he left the oil rig, he said, he moved up to Montana with his brother, and there he ended up working for and retiring from the Montana Fish, Wildlife, and Parks. Now, we hung around with him all day at Yellow Bay, and then we made plans to meet up again the next day because he already had plans for the rest of that day. We sat around and we shot the breeze so much that we ended up not really doing any fishing that day, so we planned to just get back to the campsite, and me and Dad said we'd have some canned goods that we brought with us for our dinner instead of fresh-caught fish. We got back up to the campsite, and immediately we knew something wasn't right. Someone had been through there. It was clear. Everything had been gone through. Everything had been touched and moved, and quite a few things were tossed around. Our tent, it looked a little worse for the wear, like something had just been messing with it, tugging on it. But it didn't pull it all the way out. The ground stakes were still there, if a little askew. Otherwise, it looked like the tent had escaped the worst of it. Me and Dad, we thought it was probably just someone else who had used that spot before, and just by chance had come back that afternoon thinking they were going to use it. And they were mad as heck that we had gotten there first. Well, we guessed that was what it was anyway. And in a way, that is exactly what happened. We just had it wrong a little bit, some of the detail. So we made our dinner, and we did all the cleanup. We made sure that you didn't have any food that you could smell inside the camp. Everything was closed, canned, good, straight from the grocery store. But we still hung everything we had in a tree several hundred feet outside the camp area until we were going to carry it all down the next day. The trash, I mean. Me and Dad sat around and we talked for a long time, like we always did. I loved that part of these trips. While we're sitting there, though, we were hearing some really strange things out there, and things we just couldn't figure out what it was. But we figured we were in a place that we really didn't know, and there were all kinds of sounds there that we just didn't know. Every now and then, the weirdest thing was we would hear a woman screaming kind of sound. It was different than any of the bobcats or lions I'd ever heard before while we were out, and it sounded like it was a mile or two down the mountain away from us. We could hear it all right, but it wasn't real close. Dad listened, and I asked him, "What is that?" He said, "It's just the regular bobcat or mountain lion." I said, "Dad, that doesn't sound like one." He said, "Son, it's a bobcat or a lion. Don't worry about it." And so I didn't worry about it. That was that. When the fire burned down, we banked the coals real good, and we went on in the tent to get some sleep. I fell asleep first, I think. Now, later, Dad said that he hadn't fallen asleep yet when he heard something walk into camp. Dad's first thought was, naturally, that it was a bear. We had bear spray, but that's only optimal to use if you have some distance between you and the bear. Dad did have his Remington 700 bolt-action rifle. We carried it mostly just in case of a bear, but God knows we didn't want to use it. But you have to be a special kind of stupid to go sleeping in well-known grizzly territory and black bear territory and not take a rifle for protection. That doesn't even include the other fun carnivores out there like wolves, and they are out there in that forest, make no mistake. But with the bears, when they're that close, you don't have much chance of doing the usual surprise them and scare them off tactic. I mean, we're talking it was walking just a few inches away from us, right on the other side of our nylon tent when I got woken up. You scare it now, and it just might slash right through the tent and grab you because you're so close. So here is where Dad puts his finger over my lips, and he shakes me awake. As soon as he did, I knew right then something was in our camp. You not only heard the light thudding as it walked in the cleared area of camp, but you could almost feel the tiniest vibration from the dirt under me. I knew it was a big creature out there from the sound of it. And of course, well, I thought, that could only mean one thing. One big bleepity bleep bleep bear. I trusted my dad to know exactly what to do in this situation. He's just one of those guys who spent his whole life in and out of all kinds of areas. He's done all kinds of hunting and camping all over. It's just his thing. I knew that Dad had ran up against bears before, and it had never ended with harm on either side, him or the bear. So I trusted him. I lay there, pretending for all intents and purposes to be dead. I was hoping that whatever it was just going to sniff all those weird human scents out there and then mosey on down the way. I didn't recognize it right away, but when Dad was waking me up, he had already sat up in his sleeping bag, but he made sure I didn't move. As I lay there, I heard the soft sound of him grabbing the rifle. It was dark, and the only reason I knew what was going on was because I heard the slight snicking sound of his wedding ring as it made light contact with the gun when he put it in his hands. It was a very tiny sound, and if I hadn't heard it 1,000 other times in my life, I might not have known what it was. As soon as he did that, though, the footsteps stopped outside. Later on, when we talked about this, in that moment, Dad said that he thought it wasn't a bear already because he could tell it was walking on two legs. But me, I didn't know that. Dad had taught me some basics on hunting when I was younger. but he quickly and rightly picked up on, I don't have a taste for hunting, but I did like the hiking and camping. So it's fair to say that everything that I knew at that point about hunting and animals in general, I had learned from my dad. But it's also even more fair to say that I did not learn everything he knew about hunting and animals. So he listened, and he knew that something out there wasn't adding up. But me, I didn't know it. He said he still wasn't thinking Sasquatch or anything like that. He thought two legs, not a bear, but probably a seriously big human out there. And that seemed logical at that point. But I didn't know that then. There was a lot I didn't know right then. It seemed like forever that we just stayed in the tent and listened in the dark. I always wondered why Dad didn't go out to confront them. I asked him once, and he just said because something still didn't seem right. He also said if someone was so desperate they needed to take something from the campsite, let them take it. It wasn't worth their life or his. But he said curiosity was getting the better of him, and that's when, very slowly and quietly, he nosed his way through the loops on the privacy inner closure flap of the tent so he could look out the screen section. He did that, and he didn't move for probably a minute or more. I just stayed where I was and waited. After a few minutes, Dad sat back down on his heels, and he whispered to me that it was all clear. They were gone. I asked him, what had gone on out there? But he just kept telling me not to worry. They were gone. He then unzipped the tent, went out, and stirred up all the coals, and he put more wood on the fire. Soon, we had a very respectable fire going. I found my phone and my belongings, and I turned it on to see what the time was. It was 4:08 a.m. Yes, I had my phone with me, but there's no reception up there, so I didn't really turn it on. It also wasn't something that I was going to leave behind at home for a week, and I did use it to get pics and videos and things. But I had to plan to take those pics and stuff, and I had to get the phone out and turn it on. So it wasn't always there for me to just grab and take a quick pic. I just have to say that because the first thing someone always says is, why didn't I get pictures or videos? Because, jackass out there wondering that, the whole point of my time with my dad was to not be connected to electronics while out there with him. And it was hard for me to do that. Remember, I was just 16 at that time. Social media was and still is my whole world. But that was my dad's rule. Now, well, I'm older, and I have to say, I'm really glad he made that rule. I have amazing things in my memories now, things that I surely would have missed if my nose had been stuck down looking at my phone. Anyway, it's 4:08 a.m. We go ahead, and we just get up. We turn on the flashlights, and we're checking all around the camp. We didn't find anything missing, but everything had been moved. As the sky started lightening up in the next hour or so, we could see more and more of the surrounding area. That's when we saw, very clearly, the huge footprints that were all over the outer edges where we hadn't walked since getting up. The area was somewhat compacted dirt, but you could still see the outlines of disturbed dirt where it had walked. I said to Dad, you said they left, but you didn't tell me that they was a bear. And that's what I thought they were. It was the only plausible thing I could think of, right? I mean, and I thought he just didn't tell me because he didn't want to frighten me. I had heard of Sasquatch by that time. Heck, who hadn't by 2017 at one point or another in their life, especially living in Idaho near Montana? But I didn't think they were real. I put Sasquatch right up there, right next to aliens and leprechauns. Dad just shook his head at me. I don't know if he meant to say, no, it wasn't a bear, or if he was shaking his head at me, meaning, no, you just don't get it, son. Finally, he just said, well, that was one heck of a bear, son. And that made me kind of laugh, and I was kind of sorry that I hadn't seen this one heck of a bear. But my dad wasn't laughing when he said it. He had a strange look on his face, and he was just working on putting everything around the camp right again, and he was repacking our things properly. I did notice, however, that he kept the rifle right on his shoulder the whole time, and he was on high alert, looking all around, even long after the sun was up. I put it down to just watching out for that bear to come back. We double-checked everything in camp, then we put it out of our minds, or so I thought, and we headed on down and spent the day with Dad's old friend. We got us some yellow perch, and we cooked it up down there near the shore. I wanted to take it back up to the camp for nightfall and have dinner, but Dad insisted we do it right there, right then, in the afternoon. He said he didn't want any fish smells lingering up there around our camp after our bear scare the night before. So we stop at one of the little stores, and we get ourselves one of those little bags of charcoal that you just light the end of it and the whole thing sets on fire. And with Dad's friend's help, we found an area that was for RVs and campers, but had some picnic tables and those kinds of grills that are on poles. We grilled our fish there. It wasn't what I wanted, but, you know, I wasn't the adult making the decisions, and overall, it was a great day. As we're eating, Dad's friend, of course, wants to know all about the bear and tells him that he needs to call it in to the bear ranger as a sighting. But Dad kept saying no, there was no need for that. That's when Dad's friend looked at him a little weird. He looked at him for maybe a second longer than normal, and cool as a cucumber, he said to my dad, "You didn't see no bear, did you?" I'm looking at both of them like they were both crazy. What is he talking about? Please, it was a bear. Then, to my surprise, my dad said, "Well, I don't rightly know." I couldn't get over the hesitancy in my dad's voice. My dad is not the kind of guy who second guesses himself or ever sounds hesitant. If you knew him, you'd know what I mean. Dad's friend just kind of grunted softly, like he was saying, "Yep, thought so." And then he sort of nodded his head forward a few times like he was thinking about what Dad said. Then he said, "You know, maybe you best move that camp of yours on down here to the shore. What do you say, Hoss?" Dad said he'd think about it, which I knew meant he darn well wasn't going to. First rule about my dad, when he says he'll think about doing something, that's just his way of saying, "No, stop asking me. I don't want to just have to say no." But his friend nodded again, and he told Dad he was smart to go ahead and eat down here. And then he asked all kinds of questions about our setup up there at camp, how we were doing things and stuff. Then after a while, the talk naturally moved on to other things. When we were getting ready to leave, Dad's friend stopped him again and said, "I suggest you think again about moving your camp." Dad politely nodded and said, "Well, he'd see how things go that night." We got back up to our camp, looked around, and were relieved to see that nothing looked moved. Dad said that he was probably going to sit up a while longer, maybe all night. He was going to watch for that bear. I said, "Hey, Dad, I'll sit with you." But he said, "No, go on in the tent and get some sleep." And I said, "Heck no, I wasn't going to leave my dad out there all alone with maybe a bear tearing through the camp." I said, "If bears hear people talking, it keeps them away, right?" He just looked at me, and he didn't answer. So we're both sitting up really late, and we're talking and talking and talking. Dad had gotten lots of wood out and ready to feed the fire all night long, if need be. Me, I'm thinking this is fun. It's only now that I look back and after talking to him that it wasn't fun for Dad. After a few hours, though, I was really fighting the urge to just fall asleep. I was sitting there and nodding off really bad. But Dad wasn't. We were both sitting with our backs to the tent opening, and the fire was out in front of us. We weren't real close to the fire. It was pretty hot out. It had now gone quiet, mostly because I was nodding off to sleep and had shut up. Then we heard the sound of something, and it was coming right up the main trail that ran about 70 feet from our camp. You could hear it from that far off. Whatever it was big and moving in a steady direction. Then it got louder when it sounded like it left the trail and started going through the brush, making a beeline right for us. Now you know that woke me up. Me and Dad, we both looked the way it was coming. It kept coming right up to within 25 feet from the edge of our camp area. We both were fixed looking at the area, but I couldn't see anything. Once or twice, I thought maybe I saw eyes shine, a golden color, and then I thought it's probably some raccoon hanging on the edge of a tree. Boy, was I wrong. Now, Dad had now stood up and had his rifle at a ready position, but he didn't have it truly aimed yet. I got up, and I was standing behind him. The whole thing, it was a very surreal moment just standing there waiting for something to happen. It was like some horror movie. But what happened next was a sound I don't know how to describe. There was something going on out there. I mean, you could hear the sound of like some kind of light exertion and heavy breathing, and then the sound of something like a sucking sound, something giving way in the dirt out there in the darkness, and some brushes, some branches brushing. Then that's when it really happened. A sapling, maybe 3 or 4 feet tall, and the trunk maybe as big as your finger or maybe a small thumb, came flying out at us, root ball and all. Loose dirt was flying right along with it, and right along with it was the screaming woman sound that we had heard the night before way off in the distance. You know, that sound that Dad said was definitely a bobcat or a mountain lion. This sapling comes out, and it partly hits my dad, and at the same time he's ducking and I'm ducking, and the sapling bounces off and partway goes out into our fire, root ball right into the flames. Now this kicks the intensity and light of the flames in the fire down a few notches, and then you smell fresh dirt burning, which is a very distinctive smell. Now, Dad's rifle is full ready and aiming. I'm like, Dad, what the heck was that? He just shushed me. He starts yelling into the darkness like it's a bear out there he's going to scare away. The whole time I'm thinking, yeah, well, since when do bears throw little baby trees at you? Then came the clumps of dirt flying at us. I guess it grabbed clumps of dirt because there were no rocks around that it could find. I really don't know. After the second clump dang near nailed me in the head, Dad fired off one shot from the rifle way above wherever it was in the trees, and immediately we heard the sound of it beating a quick retreat right back out of there. I ain't gonna lie, I was scared to death at that point. Me and my dad had been doing all kinds of camping and hiking for lots of years, but I had never been truly scared before when he was right there with me. But I was right then. In a minute, after we waited after it left, Dad told me to go get that tree off the fire, or rake over the coals, and put more wood on. So that's what I did. The whole time, he's standing with the rifle, looking everywhere. I know this has gotten to be really long. There's just a lot that I don't want to forget. After a while, we had calmed down, but boy, was I wide awake now. Dad, he actually still wore a watch. I mean, you old Gen Xers crack me up. Who wears a watch anymore? Except for my dad. But he looked at his watch, and he said it was going to be a really long night. I said, what time is it? He said, just after midnight. I thought, well, there's no way I'm going to fall asleep after all that. But guess what? You bet I did. And so did Dad. Next thing I know, there's all kinds of screaming and yelling going on. There's a Sasquatch over there screaming, and my dad is yelling at me to get up. Oh, he had the rifle, and he had given me the bear spray. I forgot to say that. Thanks, Dad. You know, that bear spray is really going to help against a big old Sasquatch, but better than nothing, I guess. So I'm awake, and I'm standing up as fast as lightning. And right there across the fire, I couldn't believe what I was seeing. There's a huge Sasquatch. My dad's yelling for it to get on out of there like it was a bear. And I'm yelling at my dad to just shoot it, shoot it. It was total chaos. I can't even tell you. Screaming and yelling in the dark and fire. It was crazy. Dad raised his rifle up to aim, but he still didn't shoot. And you know, that Sasquatch didn't seem to understand what that rifle meant because it didn't leave or back off at all. Let me tell you here what I was looking at across the fire from me. 8 feet tall, grizzly bear brown, mean and downright ugly looking, and it was built like a Mack truck. When it was breathing in and out, even over all that ruckus, you could hear the air percolating down in its lungs with every breath. Think like a purr from a cat, but not quite so soft or defined. It looked to me, and you're going to laugh, but it looked to me like it was SpongeBob in fur. It was square and blocky. Then you saw these arms and legs. I know, it's funny, but that really was my first thought comparison. It was like a huge block of fur and muscle waving all around in the dark. I can't tell you about the eyes or the nostrils or those kinds of details. It was probably 30 feet from me, and all I had for light was a dying fire. But I could see the light and dark in the fur when it would move. It was showing all the muscles. When it screamed, you could see inside its mouth. You could see the teeth, and you could see the tongue. The teeth that I saw, they just looked like a line of light color in the mouth. I couldn't see enough to say if any of them were sharp or not, but I didn't get that impression that they were fangs, you know. This thing, though, it was mad. When it roared and screamed, it tipped its head down with its chin on the chest, and it kept its eyes on us the whole time. Dad raised his rifle and shot another round above the creature's head, but not hitting it. The creature stopped mid-scream, and before I knew it, it whirled around and ran almost right down the side of the mountain where we were on. Now, we weren't on a ledge or anything, but most of that area by us, it wasn't level or flat, just where we were, which is why we chose it to camp on. It really was a long night for us from that point on. Before dawn, we were on the last of the wood for the fire, and we had already packed up almost everything. Well, I am the one that packed up most of it. Dad, he kept watch over everything with the rifle while I did it. I kept asking him, "What was that, Dad? What came in our camp?" Finally, he said, "I might be wrong, but I think it was a Sasquatch." Now, I had this thing going on when I was thinking on it at the time when he said that. Part of me knew what I saw wasn't anything like I'd ever seen, and it was nothing like you could go see in a zoo. Then there was the other part of me that refused to accept it when my brain tried to whisper the word Sasquatch, and it rejected it no less when my dad said Sasquatch. I tell you, it was a surreal night. At first light, we had already packed up and we were walking down that mountain. When we got down there, Dad called his friend, and then he came out and we all talked a bit. Me and Dad, we hadn't hardly slept at all, and the next thing I know, after the weirdest, scariest night of my life, I'm suddenly in the sunlight again and we're all fishing at the lake. It was so unreal. I keep saying that, but it feels like everything out of a dream or a movie, but I lived it. Dad's friend listened to everything we had to say. Then he told Dad to keep it to himself right then, that he wouldn't be doing anyone any favors by repeating it, especially neither Dad nor me. And Dad's friend made no bones about it, and he said that Dad was right. It was definitely a Sasquatch, and from the sounds of it, we might have taken its regular sleeping spot, or maybe just the spot along its migration route. And I forgot to mention to you that me and Dad are pretty sure what we saw was a male. I mean, I didn't see the most obvious proof of maleness, mostly because I couldn't take my eyes off its upper body and face. But have you ever done that thing where they show you different pictures of cats or dogs, and you can most of the time correctly guess from just the face if it's a boy or a girl? Well, this was like that. I've seen the Patty film, and she didn't look at all like what I saw that night. Not in the face, anyway. She looks a bit more rounded, a bit more feminine, if you can use such a word with a Sasquatch. The one we had across from us at the fire, it was more blocky in features. Like I said, think hairy SpongeBob, but a lot scarier. I mean, even the jaws when it was screaming, the jaws looked more muscular than what Patty had. Maybe it was just my view of it, but it really was bigger and meaner looking everywhere. Now, me and Dad decided to cut our week up early. We left there and we headed on up to Glacier National Park, which my dad had been to many times before, but I never had. Dad insisted that we get right back out there, and that very night we were going to camp out in the darkness again. He said he didn't want us to get too scared to ever do it again, and then I got the whole parable about falling off a horse and getting right back up on it. In hindsight, he's probably right. Dad also said that his friend told him that our experience was one in a million, and that they usually go out of their way to avoid humans, and that all the time he spent in that park, he personally had never seen one, but he had encountered a lot of people that he trusted that had. Dad said that he also asked his friend, why doesn't someone do something about them? He said a lot of the service people had no choice but to acknowledge them as real, but that was as far as it would ever go. Anything that seems too official or like some effort to do something about them, it immediately gets axed, and whoever approached that idea, they were always right out of a job real quick. Me and Dad have talked about it lots, and we do think that we mistakenly took a nesting or a bedding area. Maybe not one that was used all the time, which is maybe why we didn't see any signs. Dad, he's of the opinion that they are migratory, even if it's more like just a lion that circles its territory over several weeks. Maybe it just comes through once every 6 weeks or so, but it has a favorite spot. And we had the misfortune to pick that spot for ourselves. The other thing Dad thought about this was the first night when he heard it, he said that he kept thinking he heard it out there all through the dawn, and that it was always just somewhere outside of camp. Yes, he did see it that night, and he thinks it was the same one. But he was also certain that he was seeing something perfectly explainable. He didn't know what, but even after seeing it, his brain wouldn't let him believe that it wasn't anything perfectly explainable. He said he insisted that we stay again that night, because even he didn't believe it for himself. I did ask Dad why he didn't just shoot it. I mean, we could have had proof once and for all, and he was a really good shot with a good rifle. It was right there. But Dad said he had never shot at something that he was not 1,000% sure that he could identify. He said, what if I was wrong? What if it was some prank? What if he accidentally shot a person? He said he really didn't believe it was a person, not even now. He didn't think it could be. But he said he couldn't live with himself if there was any chance he might be wrong. Now, that's all he says he has to say about that. The only thing he otherwise said was if it had come across the fire, if it looked like it was going to hurt us, then he would have shot it. And he also said that either people out there listening can understand that or not, but if they aren't the ones pulling that trigger and they aren't the ones that have to accept the responsibility and live with it, then they aren't someone to pass any judgment. Now, I've written all this out with Dad half the time on the phone. I'll read it back to him, and he tells me I forget this or that, so I have to go back and put it all in. If it's all jumbled, blame it on my old man. He's a Gen Xer, and he gets easily confused at his old age. Sorry, that's my big inside joke with him. No offense to any Gen Xers out there. It's just my dad. Thanks, Devon and his dad. Thank you, Devon and Dad. I know, I'm getting really good long stories lately. I love them just as much as you all do. Thanks again for choosing to hang out with me. You guys really are the best. I love my Sasquad. Well, it's been a long night already, hasn't it? So I'm not going to keep you up much later. We'll be meeting up around the campfire to talk again real soon. But until then, always remember, absence of proof is not proof of absence. Thanks for listening, everyone. If you like what you've heard and want to hear more, hit the like and subscribe button, and don't forget the bell to get notifications.